He's going to return, and he's going to return in the same way that he ascended to heaven, meaning that he blessed them. They saw it, okay? And he came on the Mount of Olives. So this is also the hope for me, the resurrection and the ascension.
Right here in this city.
Right here, that he will return in the same way that the ones that they pierced him, the one whom they pierced, they will see him again, and they will mourn and cry.
Good evening and welcome to the Rosenberg Report. We are approaching Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, the celebration of Jesus' death and his resurrection, so important to those of us who believe that Jesus really is the Messiah. And there are more than 2 billion people worldwide who believe that. And as Israelis have been going through this terrible dark time of war and terror, wars and rumors of wars, the whole issue of life and death and what happens when we die, and is there any way to know God personally and be sure that we're going to be safe and we're going to be in heaven forever and ever when we leave this world. These are big issues that Israelis, all Israelis, have been wrestling with. And so what better place to come to the Garden Tomb, where so many Christians over the years, so many Christians have come to spend time in this garden, to spend time going into this empty tomb. Yeah, there's a debate over whether this is the actual place, this is the actual tomb where Jesus was buried and rose again, and not everybody believes that. And that's not what we're here to do, to define that and to discuss all those archaeological and historical facts. The point is that many Christians come here in Jerusalem, we're right next to the old city of Jerusalem, to remember what it was that happened in this city 2,000 years ago and why it matters to us. And tonight, we're going to talk to a dear friend of mine, Victor Kalischer. He is the head of the Israeli Bible Society. He is the son of the most famous, or one of the most famous Messianic Jewish believers, a Jew who really believes that Jesus the Messiah was one of the first believing families in the entire nation of Israel in 1948. And we're going to have a conversation tonight about why most Jews don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah, why he and his family and so many more Jews believe in Jesus as Messiah than ever before. In fact, I will just tell you as we start, in 1948, there were only 23 Jewish people in the entire nation of Israel that believed that Jesus is the Messiah. 23. And today, there's two different studies. One study says around 15,000. Another study says around 25,000 to 30,000. And worldwide, back in 1948, there were fewer than 2,000 Jews in the world, who believed that Jesus is the Messiah. And today, based on studies that the Joshua Fund and I have helped invest in and support, it's very interesting data that's emerging that almost a million Jews worldwide, mostly in the United States, but also worldwide, almost a million Jews believe that Jesus was in fact and is in fact the Messiah, that he died, that he rose again. That's extraordinary. That's more Jews today than at any other time in history. So we're going to talk to Victor Kalischer about why most Jews don't believe and why an increasing number do believe that the Resurrection Sunday is really true. Let's take a look at this really interesting conversation. I love this sign. Obviously, this verse from John 19. Now, in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb where no one had ever been laid. And Victor, I just want to chat with you as we kind of spend our time here in this garden tomb area. What does Resurrection Sunday mean to you? And what is it that you teach when you teach in your congregation?
Yeah. So, you know, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 that the resurrection actually is the foundation of our faith. Mm-hmm. If Jesus was not resurrected, then our faith is for vain. Yeah. This is our hope, you know. He's the first one, he's the guarantee of our resurrection, of our hope. Mm-hmm. And, you know, also, after Jesus resurrected, it is written that he stayed for another 40 days. I mean, I would live after how they treated me.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I would live, you know, to the glory and thank you, God. I finished. It's finished.
It's good that you and I were not.
And he said it's finished, right?
Jesus.
Yeah. But still, he remained for another 40 days, not one, not two, with us, with these Jewish people. You know, it's not easy, and he stayed. And it is written that he appeared. At one time before 500 people, and he appeared in different occasions, so that he made sure that the fact of the resurrection will be known, will be an historic
effect.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
It wasn't just one quick moment. One person
no.
saw him, two people saw him. 40
days and in many cases and to many people.
Yeah, 500 at one point.
Exactly. And it is even, you know, an historical recorded event that cannot be denied. Okay,
there apparently it can be, but
yes,
there are real facts.
Yeah, exactly. And the same people that that saw him and experienced that, they were asked, okay, to be his witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
So he made sure that they know very well and that they experienced him so that they can share the gospel, because this is foundation of the gospel, his resurrection.
Mm.
And you ask me what it is for me, and I'm asking myself, how can we today, me, today, be a true witness of Christ like they, in the sense that his resurrection will be a reality in our life? How can we live our lives in
because,
a way
because,
that...
Because one of the important things, right, is that the New Testament is very honest. The Gospels are very honest about the failures and the weaknesses of the disciples, right?
Mm-hmm.
So Peter's betraying Jesus three times.
Mm-hmm.
He's supposed to be the leader of the team, and he totally betrays him. All the disciples flee. The women stick, but the men are all gone. That is one of the things that tells me that the Bible is honest, because it gives the dirty laundry, as it were,
exactly.
of King David, of the disciples, of others. But it also, we see then the before and the after, right? Peter becomes the most bold of any of the 12. Why? Because he'd seen something that he had not seen before, right? So we see how the resurrection, have seen Jesus really dead and buried and then being so depressed about it. And then they don't even believe it at first. They don't even believe each other when what you saw it.
And,
I don't even really believe
it. And the Holy Spirit.
And it changed them.
The Comforter, the promise of the Father that he says, when I will go, you will receive the promise of the Father, which is the Holy Spirit. It is the presence of God in us.
Yeah.
So the resurrection is the guarantee to receive the Holy Spirit, that without it, we cannot do anything.
And if we really have come to personally believe in the resurrected Savior and we have the Holy Spirit in us, we will be changed. There's no way to not be changed. I mean, you can change more over time, but something has to change. And if we're changed, people ought to be able to see
it's more than change.
That change,
it's,
right?
It's a new creation.
Yeah.
It's not just a change. It's a new creation. Mm. It's something new that God created. Mm. And, you know, the word new in the biblical sense is eternal.
Mm.
It's not, you know, when you buy a new car after one day, that's it. You cannot receive the same amount of money for it. But it is new in the sense that it is a new creation.
Mm.
It is eternal. It is something that only God can do. And that's what he did in the resurrection.
Mm.
This is the resurrection for me. And you know, as a Messianic Jew, I'm being a little bit egoistic, but it is something that encourages me when he sends them to be his disciples, his witnesses to the world. It is also in order to complete the mission, so to speak, in order to bring the gospel back to the Jewish people, because it is all about establishing his kingdom back here and his return.
Mm.
Because at the same time that he resurrected, and actually these 40 days passes very quickly in the scriptures.
Right.
It is like, you know, you read and say, that's 40 days? What happened in these 40 days? How can it be 40 days? But these are 40 days, but they go on so fast because, you know, he's going to return, and he's going to return in the same way that he ascended to heaven, meaning that he blessed them. They saw it, okay? And he came on the Mount of Olives. So this is also the hope for me, the resurrection and the ascension.
Right here in this city.
Right here, that he will return in the same way. That the ones that they pierced him, the one whom they pierced, they will see him again, and they will mourn and cry.
Zechariah 12:10.
So this is, you know,
powerful.
It is an amazing hope. And it is the hope of the Jewish people. And another thing is that, you know, before...
But wait, there's more.
Before he ascends, in Luke 24, verse 45, it is written that he opened their eyes. He gave them an understanding to understand the Psalms, Moses, and the prophets. Now that they are going to be disciples and spread the gospel to all the nations, and it came from here, and it came through these Israelis, Jewish Israelis, okay, he gives them a special understanding. This is something that we have today. You know, we have this understanding today, and that's why we can see that he fulfills everything. That's why we are so blessed.
Not because we're so bright.
No.
God has to open our eyes.
Open our eyes.
One of our prayers has to be that God would open the eyes of anybody, whether Jew or they're Muslim or they're Hindu or they're an atheist, whatever. We just don't see it until God opens our eyes, and we do see it.
From the Old Testament to see it, you know, that's the roots. These are the roots.
I was a teenager in the 1980s. I remember there used to be these computerized, like, paintings, I guess I would say, but they were computerized, you know, images. But you would look at it, like, they would have them at the mall. I don't know whoever bought them, right? But you'd look at that, and they're like, oh, can't you see the spaceship and the moon? And I'm like, I can't see it. And they're like, no, it's right there, just squint. And I'm like, and then suddenly your eyes would adjust just a little bit, and you're like, oh, you would see something that you were trying to see so hard, and you couldn't see it. And then, you know, and that's not a great analogy, but at least, you know, you can look at the Gospels and still not see it yet. But a lot of people they're not even looking.
Once we trust the word of God to be true, and we forget about, you know, our self, and we are willing to say, God, I want to know the truth.
Yeah.
And I'm putting aside all my thoughts, all my prejudices.
Just tell me what is true.
And honestly, then there is no way by which you cannot see that Jesus the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth, is the one that fulfills the Hebrew scriptures. There is no way. The thing is that many times I think Israelis, they put rabbinical thought and Jewish culture and many other things that, you know, by themselves, I don't want to criticize them. But when they create
obstacles and they're contradictory to the actual Jewish scriptures themselves, then it's a problem.
And
it's false
God
teaching.
Said that he doesn't want that our faith in him will be, you know, based on people's knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
He wants it to be totally dependent.
I mean, on human wisdom. He doesn't want you to be, just because you know, you might be Albert Einstein, but that doesn't mean that you have a better chance to understand it than somebody who is uneducated. Now, your father is interesting, right? Because he spoke 11 languages. He really was, you know, he was a genius in many ways. So someone can't say, well, he was an idiot. What does he know?
But
on the other hand, somebody who was a child can come to faith if God opens
But he could also
eyes.
See, you know.
Let's come over. Let's give us 1 second while we go over,
you know,
and actually look at this this hill that many, you know, many believe this is a hill that looks just like Golgotha. Maybe
we talked about my father. Yeah. My father was also, because of what he passed, could see and realize that being a Jew and having keeping all the traditions and wearing all the clothes, because he came from this background, he could see that this doesn't help you whatsoever. He saw that, he experienced that. So in a way, you can say that God crushed all these Jewish background around him and took it aside and totally crushed it so that he could see this, it didn't help.
And once he saw it, he was changed forever and became passionate about talking about it.
Exactly, and when he saw the truth, he couldn't deny it.
We're in war. It's been so painful. I mean, many people are saying this is the worst that Israel has been through since the War of Independence. People are talking about it, the Prime Minister, as this is the darkest hour in the history of the Jewish people since the Holocaust.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's a time of death and where people are scared and it's been hard and people are grieving. So do you see more openness among Jewish people? Yes, during this wartime, although it may not be easy to evaluate it right now, but over the last 10 or 15 years, I mean, my general sense is that there is an openness.
Yes.
I find people asking me all the time, Jews, Israelis, about Jesus, and why do you believe that? And they don't seem as hostile as previous times, but you're much more of an expert than me. I'm just curious, what are you seeing?
So I think that there is much greater openness and seeking, especially now in this time of war. You see much more people quoting scriptures, quoting scriptures, trying to go to spiritual things, you know. So obviously many times they go to what they know, which is the Jewish traditions and so on, but they seek for spirituality. They search and seek for divine intervention. And that's the thing that, you know, I think God can use. And it gives us a lot of opportunities to share our
faith and our spiritual hope, you know, our hope that we
are
have.
More people coming into the Bible Society or, you know, there's no tourists here
no
now.
No tourists, so. Yes, but people yeah. come. And today we live in a time where people find, you know, answers and also in other ways, you know, the media, Facebook, Instagram, and so on. So people are using that and we have much more tools to share even now as we do in the media with many more people. So definitely I would say, yes, I wish it was more. I wish it was deeper. But here and here and there, you see more people that hear, that consider, and those that come to faith. You know, actually today, I gave a study Bible for someone who is discipling a new believer. And a week ago, a young girl, you know, like in her 20s, she came and she said, I have a friend that I shared with her my faith for many time, for a long time. And now she said, you know what? I really want to read it myself. I want to examine it myself. And she came to us for a Bible for her. So, yeah. And, you know, we share it on the streets with people. And we see that there is much more seeking and questions. And people are willing to listen. I pray that God will use it in order to sow, you know, to plant a seed that will bring fruit, will bring life. But but I would say the answer is yes.
Okay, that's during this war, but I would say even, I mean, I remember when we started the Joshua Fund, that was 2006, and we had then a conference a few years later here in Jerusalem, 2008. And just before that 2008 Epicenter Conference, somebody, a Jewish extremist tried to blow up and assassinate a Messianic pastor here in the land, David Ortiz. It happened to be his 16-year-old son that opened up this Purim gift basket that he thought was just treats, and it turned out to be a bomb. Almost killed him. Thank God it didn't. But I feel like if you go before that time, using that as a marker, there was a lot of hostility. Not people bombing all the time, but I mean, you know, there was a lot of issues. Congregation facilities were firebombed and people's tires were slashed. And but it seems like the last 15, maybe 20 years, I'm not sure how to judge it, there's been enormous amounts of openness. It doesn't mean people are all coming to faith in Jesus here in Israel, but curiosity. And we see that, you know, the metrics on social media of, you know, people watching these videos of people sharing their testimonies of how they came to faith and what have you. There's been enormous interest. What do you attribute that to as we stand in front of an empty tomb, the empty tomb?
I think that there is a greater openness in the society today in general. I think that we're also going, I mean, it is 80 years since the Holocaust. You know, if you'll come in 47 or 48 and say, I'm a believer in Jesus, it would sound, it will be on the background of, you know, of the Nazis being Christians. So that will be like a comparison. How can you be like them? So there is a big change. I think that today many Jews realize that there are many Christians that loves us. Okay, and I think the Joshua Fund reflects that in many ways that you do in Israel and engage
many. Unconditional love. We want you to believe in Jesus, of course, but if you don't, it's not like we're going to be hostile and we will help and bless Israel no matter what.
The friends of Israel in the world are the evangelical believers. And I think more and more people know that. I think also that the local body in Israel is growing and many more people have experienced a Messianic Jew and realized, you know,
Messianic Jews are serving in key units, units actually.
They're serving, they are in the military part of the society, they are in schools, they are in hospitals, they are
lawyers,
in,
teachers, lawyer, doctors.
Every aspect of the society.
So that's a big change.
Yes, and I think that in overall they have a good reputation. If I take the army, for example, I can tell you that many of the believing soldiers are the ones that are being recognized as best or very good in their units. Okay, so that's something which is very good. And I think that we also engage with a lot of supporting, helping, coming alongside the needy in our societies. So with the help of evangelical Christian organizations.
Amen. You grew up in this home. You saw that it wasn't popular for your father and family to believe in Yeshua. There was a lot of resistance. There was persecution. I mean, it was not an easy thing. But you were a naval officer. You worked for the Intel Corporation. You could have been very successful in business. But you decide, no, I believe the Lord wants me to run the Israeli Bible Society. Why? What's the resurrection story mean to you? And why have you devoted your entire life to making sure that every Israeli has a chance to read the Bible for themselves?
First of all, it is a calling. And if I'll not say it, I'll be lying to the truth.
Okay. We don't want you calling. To be struck by lightning today.
No. It is a calling. At a certain age, God gave me, at a young age, God gave me a dream. And in short, in which I was handed a Bible. Okay? And I didn't understand why. That's the short version of that. Okay. But just let's put it now aside. Now, on top of that, all my life, okay, were... in a way destined, if you like, were directed to that, because I grew up as a first generation of Messianic believers in the land. Mm. I grew up in the first...
Meaning you were born here.
I was born here.
And you came to faith in Yeshua
here. As an Israeli. I experienced firsthand what it is to be an Israeli who believes in Jesus. There is no Israeli before us, our generation, that experienced that. A Jewish Israeli that believes in Christ for 2,000 years in the first Messianic congregation in Israel. So that's, you know, that's the timing and that's what God has done. I couldn't do that. You know, I don't decide when I will be born. I was born into a Jewish believing family that came to faith in very special, you know, circumstances. After a Holocaust, my mother is Iranian, came to Israel and came to faith.
That's a whole other story unto
itself. It is during my life, you know, like as a youngster and so on, that God is really bringing the people of Israel to the land of Israel, building Israel as a nation here, and building the remnant, okay, of believers in the land. So we are the first, you know, generation of believers after 2,000 years.
Well, we're right here at the empty tomb, so, you know, we should go in and see if it's still empty. No, after you, my friend.
Okay, thank you. Joel, it's still empty.
It's still empty. Still. Praise God.
And I tell you something?
Yeah.
One day, our grave will also be empty. Amen. Because we'll be with Him.
That's an amazing hope. And I think it's really hard for people who don't know Jesus and they... to think, well, where am I going to go when I die? Like, that's a big deal. And you can either be terrified about it or you can ignore it. But we need to know, are we going to sign up, as it were, with a resurrected Messiah? Or are we going to take a gamble and jump into history, into eternity, without any hope of going to heaven?
Where is your sting? Death, right? Yeah. Death has no... claim or victory over us. Nothing. There's no power over us.
It's not a philosophy we're saying yes to. It's a person who died, was buried, and rose.
It is real. This body is just a vessel. It's nothing, you know. One day we don't need this vessel. We are free from it, and we are with Him.
Amen.
That's our hope. Amen.
So grateful for you, brother.
Thank you
for what you believe and thank you for what you teach.
Amen.
And the Bibles that you give out and make available.
And thank you for all your help, for standing with us, for supporting us, enabling us to do so much.
Resurrection Sunday reminds us, this is the only thing that really matters.
Amen.